Commissioner of FFL with the one and only, all right, Anthony Armstrong. Man, what's going on?
With Forbes in the building now, with Emmanuel Forbes in the building, I got to claim the original 13. You know what I mean? I got to claim that.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, the new cats are cool, right? But they can't forget the OGs, man.
You got to look to the past and love on the past a little bit. You know what I mean? So
I mean, I'm talking about the two seasons you played and the struggles you went through. You know, the first season with being 4-12 and the second being 6-10, man. You know, you was trying to make plays, man, trying to make that team win, in 2010 and 11. So yeah. I know you was making those plays. I was like, man, I got to bring the real 13 up, man, Anthony Armstrong. So how you been, man?
Man, I'm good, man. I can't complain. Been getting reconnected with my Commanders and DMV folks on Twitter and, you know, doing a little podcast. Believe in Commanders podcast, and that's been fun, man. I've been breaking down film lately, looking at Sam Howell and just all of that stuff. So everything's good on this side, man. Everything's good.
Speaking of Sam Howell, man, I mean, what you think our boy gonna be cooking this year?
I think Sam is gonna do pretty good, man. Like everybody is harping on he's only had one game and 17 passes, but when you go and look at the tape, you're looking like, hey, there's actually some pretty good stuff on there, Now I've started to kind of pivot to look at some of the Chiefs games and see how the offense could look. And I'm seeing a couple of things that Mahomes does that I've seen Howell do. Exactly. Now, I'm not saying it's the same guy, but he's got the ability to throw at different angles, and he's got some moxie about him. He can put the ball downfield. I'm excited for what he's going to do. I mean, I don't think he's going to throw for 5K, but I think he could definitely get close to 4,000.
I mean, like you were saying, I mean, the Dallas game, even though, you know, it didn't matter much, but I mean, he was slinging it, man. I mean, I remember those deep balls he was throwing. He was right on point on those. And I feel like he had a good sense of pressure, you know. So he'd been moving around the pocket a lot in that Dallas game that I seen. So I think he should be good, man. I mean, speaking with that, man, Eric Bieniemy. Hey, this is something different now. This is not ordinary. I mean, I feel like I'm getting my engine starting a little too early. Dan's gone too, right? Dan is gone too. This is a 20-year change, right?
Oh, yeah.
What do you think's
good? Turning.
This is a different flip. I mean, look, every year, you know, we get that one sign in, right? Dan puts that one crazy ass sign in, that big name in there. I'm like, oh man, this gonna change. This year gonna be different, right? You know, now we figured out that was just a whatever, right? Now it's for real. This is really a different change. What do you think is going to happen this year, bro? I mean,
man, it's a positive all the way around. I mean, you get new ownership up at the top, right? You change ownership. That should happen in about a week,
right?
And get that done before training camp. I think that's probably the most important thing, to go into the season without having to deal with all of that talk. Like, when's it going to happen? Let it happen now, right? They're going to have that special meeting on the 20th, so a week away, that they're going to have that meeting. So that's big, number one. That'll get the fans back riled up. And I think everybody that vowed to never go to a game as long as Dan Snyder was the owner, they need to get their ass back to FedEx, right? Get back in FedEx, make that place packed, and don't sell your tickets to opposing fans. Like, week one, it's got to be all burgundy and gold out there, okay? You really got to represent and hold it down for your team. But EB, the energy that he's bringing, the accountability that he's bringing, the resume that he walks in with. I mean, I don't care what people say. Oh, he's under Andy Reid. The dude walking in with two Super Bowl rings. All right? Exactly. He's been under Andy Reid for 10 years. If you can't soak up some sort of knowledge and information from Andy Reid being in that room with him for that long, then something's wrong. And I don't think that he's going to step in here and disappoint. Now, I don't, you know, they don't think they're going to go off and start scoring 30, 40 points a game. But the way that we've heard about him pushing the players and saying, hey, get out of the huddle faster. You need to execute on your plays better. Like, he's setting the standard of what he expects his team to do. And then there was a clip of Andy Reid down there. He's like, hey, if you want to be average, we can practice average.
Right.
And And I have a trainer of mine, a friend of mine, who said before to his campers, hey, you have my permission to be average. And most folks are going to be like, well, I don't want to be average.
Right.
I want to be better than average. Right. So if you're real, you're going to step up and be like, I don't want to just be 8-8. That's not good enough. I want to be better than that. Right.
Exactly. Now,
having that coach come in, push the players like that, get the most out of them. I'm excited for what they're going to do.
Exactly.
It's going to be exciting for
me. I mean, it's just really exciting. And like you were saying, you know, people were saying like, hey, man, you know, Ben me won that Super Bowl because of Andy Reid, right? I mean, but they're kind of forgetting the fact that, you know, I'm sure he has a little more conversations going on with Patrick Mahomes and the whole offense than just Andy Reid, because Andy Reid, he's looking at the full picture, right? I mean, Eric Bieniemy's, I feel like he's actually building their foundation, what he did in Kansas City. So, you know, I mean, I definitely think he's going to come here and, you know, definitely change the stuff around here in a great direction. So it's going to be amazing to see. You know, I can't wait. And like you were saying, I mean, that first game against the Cardinals, hey, I feel like the stadium is going to be a different type of pack. The pack that we haven't. It needs to be. I think it will be because of the whole situation, you know, with Dan being gone and all that. I think it's going to be a different vibe. It's going to be the energy. It's going to be finally seeing all the stands, you know, full with burgundy and gold. So I definitely think it's going to be a different vibe this year.
Oh, yeah. Take them tarps off the top. Take them off and fill them with people. I mean, that place needs to be rocking. Like, I wish I could make it back for week one. I can't. But I'll try to get back for a game. I think the one against the Bills is the one I got my eyes on. So hopefully the team has a few wins under their belt leading into that matchup.
For sure. Hey, we can definitely link up, man. I'm just a phone call away. But right. But how you call it, man? You play with Jim Zorn and Mike Shanahan. I mean, let's not talk about Jim Zorn, but hey, what do you think? Which coach you think had a better feel of the game, man? I mean, I already know the answer, but
man. When I got to Washington, I came from Miami, and that's when that whole Bill Parcells and the Cowboys conglomerate moved down there, right? So you had a very strict place. People were afraid to cough wrong because, frankly, every week it was like three or four players were cut, and I'm on practice squad, and I'm like, Lord have mercy, I'm not trying to be a part of that, right? Like, I was like, I don't want to play. Like, y'all, people touch the field and get cut, right? Like, I just got here. So, going to Washington, it was a much different, there wasn't any respect for Jim Zorn. I mean, let's just keep it straight and 100. Yeah. I mean, you go into a meeting, like, I didn't want to have, I had my cell phone on silent. My cell phone would be on silent in the locker room at when I went to the facility at Washington. I get up there, man, folks was on their phone in the meeting. Head coach up there talking, they over there texting. I'm like, y'all really don't respect Buddy. And I mean, the way he got the job, I mean, I could see, but it was a major flip for me, right?
Right.
When Shanahan come in, you know, he comes with some clout. You know, he has Super Bowls, and he brings Kyle Shanahan, and then he's had success in Houston. So it was some excitement, man. It was able to really showcase skills in front of a new set of people. I always felt like I just needed to get the right opportunity and look and be in front of somebody on an even slate, right? Where they're not invested in past draft picks or not invested in who's already there. They just want to put together a team they can put on the field. But the team responded better, even though the on-field performance and the record didn't really show it. I think that the team responded better under Shanahan.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Rather than that time, well, more wins always helps, but you know, I'll take what we got, you know, at that time.
Right, and then you know, at that time too, I mean, with those 2 years, you was playing Rexy, and McNabb. So I mean, who do you think brought the best game out of you, man? I mean, quarterback wise.
Man, I tell you, honestly. Whenever we traded for Donovan, my first thought was I got to be his Deshaun Jackson in Washington. And that was my first thought. Right. So I was just trying to make plays and build his trust and gain his trust.
Right.
As you know, while I'm gaining the coach's trust. So all offseason, it was like, hey, if I get a play, I got to make a play. You know, throwing it up to me, I got to make that play.
Right.
And then when Rex came in, it was kind of weird going through that transition. It's kind of like, It's like you're the kid and then the parents are splitting up and they bring in like another, you know, boyfriend or girlfriend, and you kind of like, I don't really know them, but I gotta get to know them a little bit. I love playing with Rex because he was a gunslinger and everybody's like, oh, he's gonna throw interceptions, but that's the way he plays. But he trusts his receivers, he trusts his teammates, and there'd be times in the huddle he'll call a play and then he'll be like, yada yada yada, double go, and then he'll look up at you. And I'm like, oh, okay, bet. I already know. Like, you finna throw me the rock. Like, that's that. It was just a little unwritten communication.
Right.
He understood their offense. He could see, you know, matchups. And like, I think about a play in, it was in like a 2-minute drill in practice. And I had this little over route, and it was against a Tampa 2. And London Fletcher was the linebacker underneath who had to drop with me.
Right.
I'm faster than London. And Rex understood that. Understood, you know, where I needed to go. And he snapped the ball and just lobbed it like 15, 20 yards right in the middle of the field. And I just ran up underneath it. And it was like magic. Like, we were on the same page with that. So playing ball with Rex, like, you already knew he was going to get a chance. But then Donovan, like, he had the arm to throw it all the way over the field anyway. So
And the name as well, you know, I feel like it's all that. It's just how the game, how the business runs, man. I mean, Donovan coming in, you know, at that age, you know, I knew he was going to, I already knew he wasn't going to make that noise, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, he tried his best. And, you know, and like you were saying, you being the DeSean Jackson, you know, and I remember that touchdown, brother. You know, I think you still need that sponsorship for, you know, with the Dougie dance, man. What'd you think?
Man, I tell you, I just was trying to put on for Dallas, man, because the Dougie, that's Lil Will. Now, mind you, everybody wants to do the Teach Me How to Dougie. That's the California swag district.
And that's what it was at that time. Right.
No, but see, I was putting it down for Lil Will. Lil Will is from Dallas. He had a song, My Dougie, right? That's the one.
Exactly.
And when I played for the Desperados and we played in Atlanta and I had a touchdown, I did a Dougie and it was on ESPN. So I did the first Dougie that was nationally televised. The first one was kind of whack. The second one was a lot better. But
exactly.
But yeah,
I mean, put off and good thing you said the Desperados. I mean, before the NFL, you was in arena football, man. You know, playing for the Desperados and then also the Roughnecks. And how was that, man? How was arena football, man? It was just, I mean, man, it was a different environment. How did that go?
Man, arena was cool. It was definitely, it was a learning opportunity. I mean, I'll tell you the story, kind of how I got there the fast way.
Right.
I didn't get drafted, failed a physical with the Falcons. And then when I got healthy, I knew I wanted to play ball. I called the same scout that was down there in Atlanta that called me before.
Right.
And he was like, well, you need to get tape. And I was like, all right, bet. So I talked to a teammate who had an agent who knew a coach that was in Odessa. And I just took the first thing, packed up my little car and drove down there, made that team. I just had to learn the arena game while I was there. And everybody was like, man, you're so fast. We got to see you on the big field. And for me, I just told myself, I got to graduate every year. I got to move up every year. So I went from Odessa to Dallas to kind of barely playing, worked my way onto the field, and then eventually started the next year. And then that's when I finally made my way down to Miami. But I learned so much in Dallas. I learned so much from really everybody along that path, because there was a lot of guys who had been in the league or played D1 football who had kind of worked their way down into those lower leagues. I was on the opposite way. So I was taking their information, their knowledge, their tutelage, and using that to help build my game as I went up the tracks. And, you know, just you got to be in the right place at the right time. You don't know when that is, but you got to be prepared for it, right? Like, if somebody shows up today, I know you mentioned you had a comedy career. If somebody showed up today and they say, hey, we need you to do a set for 15 minutes, and we got Steve Harvey, Cedric the Entertainer, and DL Hughley out here, are you going to be like, oh, well, no, give me 2 weeks? You're going to be like, nah, let me get up here and
show what you got.
Jokes. You know what I mean? So that's just the way I took it, man. I knew where I wanted to be. I knew where I wanted to go. And going through arena was the path that I had to take, and I'm thankful for it because I met some really good people and learned a lot.
Sure.
I really,
I'm sure you learned a lot. I mean, built that foundation, and I mean, obviously, you know, it did pay off. I mean, you was with the, you know, us, you were with the Redskins, aka Commanders, Dolphins, Jaguars, Cowboys, right, and the Browns. So you know, I mean, that's a amazing career right there. And, you know, I'm thankful enough that, you know, you did the Dougie with us more, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So, for sure. So, you know, speaking of that, I mean, what do you think, who do you think the best organization you played for, man, with those,
man,
you
know? The best organization there, I would say all of these different teams have a little bit going for them. I think the fans are crazy loyal up there in Washington. You already saw they were voted the most loyal.
For sure.
And you can see that, right? I mean, they've been through hell, been drugged through hell for the past, you know, quarter of a century. Right. There's some ups and downs, but a lot more frustration than success.
Right.
Dallas, I mean, I have to applaud Jerry Jones, just the way he takes care of his people.
Right.
There are people that are still working for the organization that have been there for,
right,
you know, 10, 15, 20 years. I can't say the same about that in Washington. There was a lot of turnover, right? A lot,
right,
of turnover in Washington. And I mean, obviously now you see the allegations and that investigation that went down. So you can see,
right,
maybe that wasn't the best work environment.
Right.
Cleveland has a bomb facility. They have a lot of things where you're like, okay, this can be good.
Right.
Just for some reason, the on-field performance isn't matching. Cleveland deserves a winner.
Right.
Miami was solid. Like I said, my first time in, so it was kind of a culture shock seeing people get cut left and right like that.
Right.
But my whole way, it was truly just thankful to be on a team,
right,
and to be able to play. Because I mean, shoot, everybody kind of got pros and cons, but just being able to play ball, man, was a blessing, just to say the least. But yeah, that's I mean, Dallas seems to, they treat their players and treat their people really well.
Right.
They take care of them, like the small things, right? You know, Jerry,
exactly,
will feed his other people.
For sure.
At first in Washington, everybody that was in the building wasn't able to go down there and get something to eat. It was only on the
that's crazy
side.
That's
it was
crazy.
Very crazy. And that,
man,
that blew my mind. That blew my mind. Like, I was like, I'm like, oh, there's a whole bunch of, like,
you couldn't go down there, you couldn't go get a granola bar or nothing.
Nah, man. So they wouldn't let anybody go down there and do that. So, and
that's,
I mean,
crazy,
and I understand, man, that you know, they're trying to separate players and the other staff and all of that. But even after, like, afterwards, just do it when everybody's done. Like, hey, you're out,
right,
of practice. Now y'all can go down and grab the rest of the food. And that's what they, right, do now. So when I went to the facility back in December,
right,
I asked that specific question. I was like, can everybody eat down here? And he said, yeah, everybody can. Yeah, obviously it is after the players are out of the way. And,
right,
then the rest of the building is able to go down and get something to eat. Because it makes no sense to have all that food and to not feed your intern, not feed your, you know, your accountants and people that are on the PR. Like, go give the people something to eat. Like, it's a whole,
that's
everybody
crazy,
in this building,
bro,
is on the same page, right?
That's so, some goofy stuff right there.
Yeah, it was a little wild.
Man,
it was a little,
man,
wild.
Man, that's crazy, man. I got to digest that a little bit, man, because that's crazy right there, man.
I mean, but mind you, I can say, like, in Miami, I never saw anybody that was upstairs. Like, the players had a back entrance. Everybody,
right,
else went through the front entrance. Their stuff was upstairs. Ours was,
right,
downstairs. I'm sure they may have had food up there. I'm sure they had a kitchen and took care,
right,
of everybody.
Yeah.
But the way Redskins Park, or now it's Commander's Center, maybe, I'm not sure what it's called now. The way it's set up is everybody comes through that same entrance up front, and then the,
right,
players go downstairs, and you know, everybody else is working upstairs. So,
right,
you'll walk in with, you know, the PR interns and all that stuff, and you're like, hey, good morning, good to see you, da da da. And then, you know, they have a little bag lunch, and you go downstairs and get something to eat. And it's like, they're like, I don't got any food. I'm like, man, let me bring you something to eat, man. What you want? You know, I'll get you a smoothie, get you some fruit, you know. So I tried to help people out. I hooked people up every now and again, brought them a little,
right,
something to eat.
For sure. Hey, man, I got the last question. And, you know, this is, you know, it's all about the children, right? It's all about the kids, you know, the future generation, man, playing the game or what have you. What's your advice for the young cats, man? You know, what would your advice would be to, you know, chase your dreams and, you know, how go about that?
Yeah, I think the number one thing, and I've been saying this as of late, it's going to be how you handle adversity. Like,
yep,
everybody wants to be super skilled and, you know, shoot the shots and run the routes and do all of the skill work. I mean, there's countless amounts of skills trainers out here. And
right,
frankly, this generation that's coming up, that's working now, probably going to be the most skilled athletes that we'll ever see.
For sure.
But how do you handle adversity, right? Like right. The path that I took, I already know a lot of people ain't going to be able to take it.
All right.
They're not going to be able to play for $200 a game and you know, practice in a parking lot and just all of the things that I went through
right.
to get there. You know what I mean? Right. You see people that kids enter transfer portals now if they don't get a jersey number. Like, right. Come on, bro. Like, you want to make it to the league and you mad that you don't get to wear number one? Get out of here. So how you handle adversity is going to be the key in any area right. of life. Like, the tough times are going to happen. And frankly, the tough times happen before you have a breakthrough.
Right.
And if you can't handle those tough times, you don't deserve the breakthrough. Right. Everybody wants everybody wants the prize, but they don't want to dig and get the gold, you know?
You know, a lot of new cast coming out trying to be, you know, prima donna, you know what I mean? Like, it's just accept what you're given, man. Just be blessed what you're given and like exactly what you were saying. But with that, man, I really appreciate you, man, coming down and chopping it up with me. And, you know, I know you're selling homes nowadays. You know, I wish you the best, man. You know what I'm saying? It's all about that cash nowadays, man. So,
man, you know, I'm trying to build a legacy, man. I got these kids and, you know, I've been able to play the game. They didn't get to watch me play, but I can play the tapes back. I can play the highlights back. Yeah. And they're like, Dad, is that you? I'm like.
And we were talking about that, man. That's what I'm talking about. You just got to get 1099 on the NFL app, man. Go back 15 years, all the gameplays. So,
yeah,
for sure. For sure, man. Man, I appreciate you coming down here, man. Anthony Armstrong, man. NFL wide receiver. Go follow him on Instagram. Rated Armstrong. The only Armstrong. And with that, man, I'm out. My boy's out. Stay tuned for more podcasts, man. Appreciate it.
Appreciate you.